Part two on the program, a public lecture by one of ours, the Honorable Minister for Information, Kujewopon Nkrumah. I have the honor to invite the leader of the school, the rector of Gimpa, Professor Samuel K. Bonsu, to officially welcome you all to Gimpa. Please, with a round of applause, help me.
So I don't need this one.
Okay. Honorable Ministers of State, Members of Parliament, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. Normally I have a much better, more exciting, more inviting voice. But in the last week or so, I've been down with something. I'm still trying to figure out what that something is. But I hope that you can still hear me, and we'll make do with the little that I have. But welcome to Green Hill, where beauty is second nature, second only to heaven. I don't think anybody has any doubt about that. Earlier this year, we sought to intensify our engagement with alumni and friends of Gimpa, and I cannot express adequately enough the joy that is going through me now as I stand here and see that vision transformed into reality with the launch of the Gimpa Law Alumni Association. The Faculty of Law, and I prefer to call the faculty Gimpa Law, has beaten all the other schools on this front by a wide margin. They have set a very high bar, no pun intended, for the other schools. But of course, this is Gimpa. We always seek to improve on things. So I can only expect that the other schools are going to look at this as the low bar and work very hard to exceed it. And obviously give Gimpa Law a run for her money. I'm fully aware that I'm addressing a room with guardians of order, the champions of legalese, the connoisseurs of whereas, heretofore, wherefore, thou for, and I put it to you. But I'm overjoyed that we have not taken the, we have not allowed ourselves and called for the need of a judge or a jury for us to be of one mind on this particular matter of the Gimpa Law Alumni Association that we are launching today. We all seem to have agreed without any intervention or interference that this is vital for our very existence. And so we are here today. And thank you for catching the anointing, all of us who are here, and believing in Gimpa and Gimpa Law. This launch represents the culmination of a tireless effort of many dedicated individuals who share a common love for Gimpa and Gimpa Law. A special thank you to Honorable Opon Nkrumah, the Dean of Law, Dinah Asante, Ben Bubuama, and many other invisible others who have worked tirelessly over the last couple of months to make this day a reality. Our rectors over the years have also provided support in diverse ways to Gimpa Law. Professor Stephen Adai provided the foundational glory on which a Faculty of Law could be built. Professor Ajmai Bedu actually built the school and set it up. Professor Franklin Menu became rector a few years later and nurtured the faculty. Then came Professor Bondi Simpson. He had been an adjunct lecturer at the faculty, delivering the very first lecture that the faculty offered to its students. Our deans also, starting with Professor Kwame Frimpong, then Professor Abochi, Sir Dennis, Alex Sanson, and now Kwaku Ajimambudu. Our hardworking faculty and staff, past and present, have all contributed tremendously to producing the excellent alumni that we are seeking to celebrate today. We have all benefited tremendously from the involvement of successive Chief Justices of Ghana, from Her Ladyship Georgina Wood through the leadership, Her Ladyship Sophia Akufu, to His Lordship Kwasi Enim Ebua. Her Ladyship Justice Tokono, the current CG, has already graced us with her presence a couple of times in her few months as CG, and we know that that is only the beginning of bigger and better things to come. Other partners, the Ghana Bar Association, Fordham University, Temple University, Philadelphia Bar Association, White and Case, Howard University, shout out to John Wood if you are listening to us in Washington, several legal firms, University of Connecticut, many individual lawyers, registrars and clerks, legal firms in and out of Ghana have all contributed to producing the kind of fine alumni that we have produced at the Gimpa Law Faculty. And we'd like to say thank you to all of them, and thank you to you for coming to celebrate this milestone with us today. With this kind of support, it is no surprise that Gimpa Law is the best in the country. There is no debate about that, so let's not even go there. Clearly, clearly, Gimpa is far more than bricks and mortar. It is a crucible of dreams, aspirations, and unending possibilities. Gimpa Law is not merely a place to receive excellent education. It is where you form lifelong relationships, friendships, pursue passions, and acquire knowledge and skills that shape us, all of us. The Gimpa Law Alumni Association will extend these benefits even further. The association will provide a platform for ending Gimpa's commitment, extending Gimpa's commitment to excellence, innovation, and service through your efforts. We have successfully carried the torch this far, and we intend to let the torch burn even brighter as we go forward. But we cannot do this without you. No man is an island, and we know you appreciate that. And this is where you all come in, alumni or not. As Gimpa Law alumni, you will serve as a bridge for alumni across generations, year groups, as some of us tend to call them, facilitating networking opportunities, enabling reconnections among old friends, creating new friendships, and expanding professional and personal circles. In short, you are representing the Gimpa spirit. Relationships, support for each other, those are part of the things that define us. Gimpa believes in mentorship. Our planned mentorship program will draw on your expertise to foster the growth and development of the next generation of alumni. We know you will accept our invitations as they come. Gimpa Law offers a wide variety of educational and professional development opportunities, including workshops, webinars, and lectures by very highly accomplished individuals and personalities. We'll invite you to many of our events, and we hope once again you'll oblige. We know that you'll join us. We are starting our new LLM programs in the new year. You can take this program anywhere, but why would you do that when you know you only get the best at Gimpa? So we know you'll all be coming to us here at Gimpa if you have need to train yourself at that level. You want the best, and we know that. And we'll make sure that we deliver the best to you and nothing less than that. Ladies and gentlemen, last be an excellent, excellent opportunity for one of us, one of our esteemed guests here, to make a major contribution to the endowment dedicated to Gimpa Law, to the extent that we are motivated, so motivated, to name the Faculty of Law after you. Willing, ready to have a conversation wherever that may lead us. Whereas we have alumni amongst us, obviously philanthropy is not the exclusive province of Gimpa alumni and faculty. So this is not restricted to alumni. Any one of us is open, we are open to generations yet unborn. Imagine, just imagine. Any takers? I'm waiting. Anyway, I'll see you after the lunch, goals and objectives. and the faculty's missions and values. We will be contacting you later this year, following up on this, asking for your generous offer. Now, generous for some of us, happy to take it right now. So Gimpa Endowment is ready, and I hope that you join us in this venture as we seek to maintain the high standards that we've set for Gimpa Law, active contributions to the country with significant impact, and continue the legacy that Gimpa has already begun to build. Again, as we go along, as we go into the future, we'll be inviting for your support. For instance, we may invite some of our legal friends to join our legal clinics, offer pro bono services to our projects like the prison projects that we have, and many others that we'll be making available to you and sharing that information with you. Now, we are here today to talk about alumni and launch an alumni association specifically for the Faculty of Law and the wonderful people who have gone through their doors. May this alumni garden of memories in full bloom illuminate our paths brightly and dispel all gloom, helping us plant a legacy for generations to come. To this alumni garden where you'll always find peace, forgetting not your mentor's promise. Please help us fire up and fuel the Alumni Association to help maintain Gimpa Law as the best in the country. It is your faculty, and we would hope that you work with us to make it yours. So welcome to Gimpa, welcome to beauty. My Gimpa, your Gimpa, our Gimpa. God bless us all, and welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Rector Gimpa, Professor Samuel K. Bonsu. Indeed, the Gimpa Law Faculty has been a big king of legal education and a source of inspiration to many individuals. We'll now take the remarks by the Dean of the Faculty of Law here at Gimpa, Dr. Kweku Ajimai Budu. Please, a round of applause.
Director of Gimpa, Professor Samuel Kweku Bonsu, our guest speaker, Honorable Kojopo Nkrumah, Minister for Information of the Republic of Ghana, Ministers of State here present, the Deputy Rector of Gimpa and Secretary of the Institute, colleague deans, faculty and staff members, representatives of the Gimpa Alumni Association, our illustrious alumni of the Gimpa Faculty of Law, members of the media, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, students of Gimpa. I bring you warm greetings this afternoon and extend a hearty welcome to you all and to our alumni who have turned or who have returned to the ever vibrant yet serene and nature-filled Gimpa Green Hill campus for this historic occasion, which the rector rightly points out is only second to heaven. We are gathered here as strategic and critical stakeholders in the administration of our dear institute to formally launch the Gimpa Law Alumni Association as an arm of the Gimpa Alumni Association. The role of alumni in shaping the all-round advancement of any institution cannot be overemphasized. You, our esteemed alumni, represent the legacy of Gimpa Law and serve as the living embodiment of the values, knowledge, competencies, and excellence that Gimpa Law has to impart. Over the past 13 years, we have come very far in our collective quest to provide quality and world-class legal education, shaping the leadership landscape in Ghana and beyond. Our successes have been as a result of the vision, selfless efforts, financial investments, and dedication of many people. I am particularly pleased to note that many of you continue to excel in your chosen fields, our alumni, becoming ethical leaders, impactful change makers, passionate advocates, outstanding academics, and contributors to society. Your achievements motivate and inspire us, and demonstrate the truly transformative power of a Gimpa Law education. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, kindly permit me to acknowledge the notable contribution of my predecessors in making this day a reality. Without their vision, committed service, and initiative in mobilizing students, staff, faculty members, and strategic partners to boost the growth of the law school, we certainly would not have such an illustrious alumni body as we have today. I do wish to particularly commend Professor Kwame Frimpong, our founding dean, who served from 2010 to 2012, Professor Ernest Kofi Abochi, who served as dean from 2012 to 2018, Professor Justice Said and his Dominica J, who also served as honorific dean from 2019 to 2020, and Dr. Alex Ansong, who served as acting dean from 2020 until I assumed office in September 2022. The unwavering dedication and commitment to our course, even till this date, has made our school what it is today, continuously impacting generations of students and alumni. I remain ever grateful for such a formidable foundation laid on which we stand today. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, while we gather here to recognize the essential role of our alumni in furthering the vision and objectives of Gimpa, we are excited to discuss the roadmap for integrating our esteemed alumni into the development of our faculty through some innovative programs and projects which we propose to foster a strong connection between Gimpa Law and our cherished alumni community. It is with great privilege that I announced the rollout of our four Master of Laws degree programs to be offered by Gimpa Law beginning in 2024, as the rector rightly pointed out. The first is a General Master of Laws degree program, and this program is designed to allow students to curate and customize their studies due to the wide range of course offerings and in accordance with their intellectual and professional interests. This program aims to promote multidisciplinary legal studies in Ghana and beyond. Again, with a view of taking advantage of the African Continental Free Trade Area, the AFCFTA Secretariat, which is hosted in Ghana, and our country's strategic location in respect of global trade, the second program we have designed is a Master of Laws degree in International Trade and Business Law. This program is curated for persons who seek to further their academic or professional journey in international trade, investment, and business across Africa with a special blend of civil and common law perspectives. Thirdly, we will be offered a Master of Laws degree in Dispute Resolution Law and Practice, which is aimed at preparing candidates for a career in cross-border dispute resolution due to the increased demand for professionals well-versed in addressing commercial, investment, and other disputes swiftly. It is in pursuance of this demand and need that we have designed this particular LLM program. Finally, taking advantage of our long-standing partnership with the International Criminal Court, the ICC, in The Hague, Netherlands, and the hosting of the African Center of International Criminal Justice at Gimpa Law, we have designed a Master of Laws degree program in International Criminal Law and Justice for students who seek to pursue a career in international and transnational criminal. To challenge Africa more than ever, we need more locally trained professionals, including legal professionals, who understand the cultural, political, and socioeconomic dynamics of international criminal law and justice to contribute to addressing the challenge. Alumni intending to apply to these LLM programs, I am pleased to announce that we are designing a platform which will expedite the application process and make it seamless for you. We are spearheading an intra-institutional collaboration with the Academic Affairs and IT Directorates to transmit your LLB transcripts of Gimpa Law. We intend to leverage on the wealth of knowledge, depth of experience, and diversity of networks of our alumni towards strengthening the bonds within the alumni family being birthed today, while safeguarding Gimpa Law's reputation as a beacon of excellence in legal education. The Gimpa Law Alumni Association can provide need-based and merit-based scholarships for current and future students of our school, as well as support such other projects as determined by the action plan of the alumni body. Such an initiative will support deserving individuals who face financial barriers while pursuing the excellent legal education offered at Gimpa Law, as we can all attest to. Ladies and gentlemen, an alumni-sponsored academic award scheme may also be considered. These awards will bear the names of individuals, special groups such as study groups, or specific year groups within the Alumni Association who could generously partner with us on this noble course. For example, we could have the 2013 Year Group Award for Overall Best Graduating Law Student, or better still, the Honorable Kojo Opon Nkrumah Award for Best Student in Law and Technology or Intellectual Property Law, for instance. Honorable, that's me telling you have to do that. Again, such honors may be sponsored by alumni even in honor of faculty members or staff. We believe that in the current competitive global academic and professional landscape, these academic awards and honors will competitively place our students and alumni to tap into the vast range of opportunities for advanced education, law practice, academia, inspiring them to reach new heights of achievement and dedication. Ladies and gentlemen, have my assurances that through our collaborative efforts, the seed we have planted today will grow formidable roots on which the Gimpa Law School will stand in years to come. To our alumni, we will continue to actively seek your input in curriculum and program development, leverage your industry experience in our activities, engage you on our faculty and as guest lecturers, and you'll find out soon enough that we have some alumni who are now full-time members of the Faculty of Law as well. And most importantly, align you to the very fabric of the institution. Indeed, this is a lifelong relationship which will be built on continuous engagement and collaboration, mutual respect and accountability. My doors, and I believe the doors of all our faculty members, staff, and management of this institute, are always wide open to collaborate with you, our illustrious alumni, in forging a mutually beneficial future for Gimpa and ourselves. In conclusion, I wish to extend my appreciation to the steering team that worked tirelessly towards the establishment of the Gimpa Law Alumni Association and today's event. The team has, through diverse ways, volunteered ideas, helped with publicity, mobilized alumni, and supported in various ways to make this endeavor a success. I say to them, Ayiko. I wish to also commend our guest speaker, a proud alumnus, for accepting our invitation to address this momentous gathering. I am highly confident in his ability to do justice to the topic, a legal framework for communicating governance. After all, we taught him here at Gimpa, and he dare not disappoint. Finally, I humbly entreat all of us to spend a few minutes of our time once the event comes to an end to reconnect with old classmates and friends, establish new acquaintances with students, staff, faculty members, invited guests, and forge alliances mutually beneficial for this long-standing relationship. May the anthem of the Institute, which is in the following words, "My Gimpa, Your Gimpa, Our Gimpa," lifts high the flag of Gimpa. My Gimpa, Your Gimpa, Our Gimpa, a world-class center of excellence, training in leadership, management, and administration, continuously enhancing capacity in public-private sectors. The evergreen Gimpa, our pride. May these words continue to shape our pursuit of the vision of our forebears to build a world-class center of excellence for us and posterity. I thank you and once again welcome you all to the launch of the Gimpa Law Alumni Association and the public lecture that will follow. God bless us all.
Thank you, Dean of the Faculty of Law, Gimpa. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we are at the climax of the first part of today's event, and we're launching the Gimpa Law Alumni Association. I'd call on the Minister for Information, Honorable Kojo Opon Nkrumah, to do us this great honor. Please help him.
Thank you. So, Honorable Ministers of State, Rector, Dean, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, the first part of my task is the very simple one, where I declare that it is launched. But before I do that, just a few remarks. As was mentioned, we will stay behind and connect with old mates when we're done. I've seen quite a good number of my classmates here. There's a place we used to eat around Westlands, and we've decided that tonight that's where we're going to eat. But the Gimpa Law story is one that we can all be proud of, starting with the faculty, and then the efforts to attract the Ghana School of Law campus here onto Gimpa campus. So there were those of us who did the faculty and then the School of Law program here as well. And then recently, the Professor Mills Center for Law was also set up here to add to the various things that are being done. And I think that's also good testimony to the good professor. I want to invite the rector and the dean to join me. I'm told that we have to count down to three while paying attention to the screen. And then the Gimpa Law Faculty will launch itself. So if we pay attention to the screen and if you join me, we will count down 3, 2, 1 and declare the Gimpa Law Faculty alumni duly launched.
May I have your attention, please?
I do understand there are some testimonials that they would want us to watch. We thank you.
Thank you. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. The Gimpa Law Alumni Association has been duly launched. Would kindly invite a performance by Opinion Crunchy. Hello. Right. Before that, we'd have the documentary, which would give us a brief history of the accomplishments of the Gimpa Law Faculty. Please, kindly let's have it.
It was on the 9th of August 2010, that was when the launch of the LLB program, the degree program, and also the dedication of the Gimpa school building was done by the Honorable Chief Justice Georgina Theodora Wood. That day, the Gimpa Law School was birthed.
But I believe that we have the best faculty of law in the country. We have been producing some of the finest legal minds. The entrance exams into the School of Law, the performance at the end of the process, all are indicators, very good indicators of the fact that we are the best in the country, and we're very proud of that.
A lot has gone into the decision to finally launch the Gimpa Law Alumni Association. It was one of the things that, as Dean, I thought it was a priority, because if you look at almost every institution within Ghana, and especially outside Ghana, the alumni play a critical role in terms of pushing forward whatever agenda that the school has.
We're very proud to see a number of our students occupying very important positions within the legal ecosystem, and it gives us a lot of pride, having been in existence for only a decade and a couple of years.
The students are the major stakeholders in any institution, and for the law faculty, our students are the reason why we're here. And we believe that just in the same way that they were major stakeholders while they were in school, when they become past students, they'll be able to support the faculty, and there are many collaborations that we can have between the faculty and these alumni.
For us at the Law Student Association, the establishment of alumni office signifies the commitment to fostering lifelong connections and collaborations within the Gimpa Law family. And we believe that this office will facilitate interactions between current students and our accomplished alumni, offering invaluable insights, guidance, and mentorship.
Since the students left here from 2010 to 2023, most of them don't come back here.
and I'm very happy that they are coming back to their school and bringing all of them again together as a big one family at the Faculty of Law.
We have some of the best legal brains in the country as faculty members, and this has actually translated to performance in the sense that over the past 5 years, our students have been topping the Ghana School of Law entrance exams. And so we have the highest number of students gaining admission to the Ghana School of Law.
I am also grateful for the opportunities that I've had through Gimpa, the intergenerational exposure that I've had, you know, to the extent that I'm able to rely on some of the contacts that I built while here. Indeed, I am impressed to see the kind of infrastructural improvements that is going on in this faculty, and I want to commend the leadership and the institution for what we all witness and can see today.
At that time when the school started, there was this spirit of contributing to build the school. So after 10 years, that spirit of giving needs to be nurtured. The law school has taken the lead, and I can promise you that other schools will do same in due course, and it's all under the umbrella of the Gimpa Alumni Association.
And I'm proud to say I was a member of the first batch of D students, the first batch of proper undergrad students to come to the Faculty of Law. So we are in this classroom because this is where we spent a lot of our time during the first year. Now I sat right over there with my friends, and what we did was we decided to call ourselves those who sat to the east of the professor, the East Legones, and then the rest of them were the Tishinungwa and other parts of Accra. So we sat here for strategic reasons because it was the best place to hear the lecture and see the lecture. I get access to the board whilst lectures were going on. And you were also hit by the AC on the hot afternoons if you sat somewhere within this region. And this is where we started our journey at the Faculty of Law. Aside the excellence in the classroom, the networking opportunities and the opportunities for growth is what has been the biggest takeaway for me as a student of Gimpa. And now that I'm back as a lecturer, I'm looking to give back to the Faculty of Law and to also train another generation of lawyers.
I will say that students who come to the faculty have a unique experience here and they come out better.
We're hoping that this Alumni Association will move forward and help to bridge the gap between what we do in the classroom, where we'll have our former students bring a certain experience and perspective into the teaching of the law as well.
And so an association that is made up of people who have been through this institution have a very close relationship with this institution, and they'll be more interested in how they can also build up the institution to make it better.
We know the myriad of opportunities this office will provide the Student Association, and we can't wait to explore them all. On behalf of the Student Association, I express our deepest appreciation to the management of the school and the Faculty of Law for pushing this initiative through.
For all alumni out there, I want us to come together and build the center of excellence that we want to see. Gimpa Law School is the best and will continue to be the best with our collective support.
I think the alumni resource at the Faculty of Law at Gimpa is unparalleled for several reasons. If you look at where our alum have gone and have settled in, it's remarkable, short of remarkable. A faculty that's less than 20 years has alum in ministerial positions, in parliament, in the judiciary, all over. So it tells you the breadth and the value that the alum has. And I think it would be good to see all of them come back, all of us come back actually, and contribute to help build the faculty and take it up to the next level so that we stop competing, not even in Ghana, but internationally across the world. So I look forward to seeing everyone. I hope everyone can come back. Let's enjoy more fun memories with Gimpa. Let's come and contribute our part to growing Gimpa.
As Dean of the Faculty of Law, this will be a plea to you to come back to the institution that we know made you who you are. So we plead that come and make the Gimpa Alumni Association the association that it is meant to be, that I know it will be, that it will be impactful, and it will help raise the next generation of legal professionals in Ghana.
I'd like to say congratulations to the Faculty of Law Alumni Association. I'd like to express my gratitude to all the people, the dean, consultant, the corporate affairs folks, the Faculty of Law, and all the alumni who have contributed in diverse ways to make this day the reality. I'm the proudest rector, given that, you know, we are now able to fully and adequately connect to a section of our alumni. And as I indicated, we hope that we'll be able to spread this across the entire institute and then have the broader alumni coming together at least once a year to share experiences and stories of their lives here at Gimpa.
Some sow, some water, some harvest. I want to believe we are at the harvest stage. And so whilst we celebrate those who are there now and the students who are currently in the school, I like to congratulate all those, especially the pioneer class, because they endured a lot. But they accepted and collaborated with us to be able to get the school going.
From greatness, we are aiming at excellence, and we count on you. In the meantime, let us continue to promote our faculty. My Gimpa, your Gimpa.
Rector, I've noticed that some of the schools are not happy because the faculty has begun the project. Please, you can do it better for the faculty. We'll take a remark from Mr. Isaac Kojo Opia Mensah. He's with the Gimpa Law Alumni Association. Please, a round of applause.
Good afternoon to everyone. Before I read what are before me, the very gentleman who lost election when he was a student happened to be one of the best guys I made when I became a student in this faculty. He vehemently campaigned against me, even though he didn't know me, because we were doing NDC NPP. Ken, I'll continue to be proud of you. On behalf of the Gimpa Law Faculty and the Organizing Committee, I extend my heartfelt gratitude to each and every one of you for gracing us with your presence at this alumni lunch today. Today marks a significant milestone in our journey as we come together to inaugurate our alumni association. The energy and the enthusiasm in this auditorium is a testament to the enduring bond we share as members of this esteemed institution. First and foremost, I want to express my deepest appreciation to our mother alumni, Mr. Norman, if he's here. Okay. And all those who have taken time to join us today. Your presence here today signifies your commitment to nurturing this alumni community and giving back to the institution that has played a vital role in shaping our lives. We also want to thank our event sponsors and partners for their generous support, without which today's gathering would not have been possible. To the organizing committee, your tireless effort in planning and executing this event has truly paid off, and we owe you a debt of gratitude for your dedication and hard work. As we embark on this new chapter of this alumni association, let us remember that it is not about reviving past memory, but also creating new ones, forging lasting connection, and contributing to the growth and success of beloved institution. Once again, thank you all for being part of this momentous occasion. Thank you, and may our Alumni Association flourish for generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Isaac Opia Mensah.
Ago munya suma mi meden kai dia yeye ane na asame nya mi ansa visana dumunti o adumunti ne atiasi ya namanda na sia wiya na akunno ni anti na mashemu e Emma Munina Tanansa. Now I dare my quam and pass the air on the sun. I blind ya, ma'am. A boy we are singing now. What the mana? No, the teacher we are, sir. And go ha. And fast, Addy. And Tibby Nick. And you know, I am, ma'am. O man kwa suwani ni iye mye jina emraso Abu siya iye yu anjina jina emraso Nti mradi ya kutere Awe ya sete Nti ana sampani mfuwa shia mune Akuni ni ninti ni biya ya ba habe suya mela Eke ya huwabum Aya nokure Benu soa emia Seni pa mi enu soa emia Umani soma minti na tumi enu nam Inti akuni ni eni inti ni Wedia ya adyompa inti Adamasyo ni adyompa Inchi mabe nya honfa soa Ananom semi jina abeme ni enyamfu minti Enu inti ni asuma me Send that and a pap and then new for a queen. Your pahum to my you answer your bedroom cassacher. Now, Yawayana, what cassacher? Your beman, your young for be beman, me dear. A dear, the flannel, your honorable. Upon Kruma, upon Chechaku, and Kruma does say, Bamani Mede, one walk us up. Timmy will say, Obishina deal again, Pampa. I dear my quam, Messia, woman, and Kuma, home, Pan, he said. Assembly no account. Asamu no wacha no Asamu no waka Nenye ni pebi ya wejina nchang Nebunum Epe makuti ya kwa jwa nteza hao Nebia ya titi wano kwa jwa Nyee ya tonsa afla wune Sablabe kasa Anuyenya mpanyi Kwa jwa wechina se Uko yanu kwa suaba Uko yanu kwa ya jumapa Uwa mse mlamu wa usia yanu Umprate sedi ya Na mwana anu ya Nkita hundie E huo Fise tachirama ya oja Tachirama ya oja Tachirama edi ya uu Enti chana sa, enkwa Ani wo wo, na watachila mansam Kodja kasa mfiebe se msoni echiri Onko oko otoda Fisa ya tete wo My young Tibia, me pessimato. Men Sabra Quabiopo Bwaho, Nancha, Maton Safro Minumon in ye Minian way. Mamma, imagine some mummy.
Let's give him a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. And I can assure him that when I'm done with politics, I'll probably go back into full-time practice. I want to start by acknowledging a number of guests who are here with us as we launch the Gimpa Law Alumni Association. The Honorable Minister for Tourism, Arts and Culture is with us, the Honorable Ibrahim Awal. Let's acknowledge him with a round of applause. Thank you very much, Senior, for being here with us. The Honorable Minister for Youth and Sports, the Honorable Mustafa Yusif is here. Let's acknowledge him as well with a round of applause. The Honorable Deputy Minister for Information, the Honorable Fatimatu Abubakar is here. Let's acknowledge her. The President's Advisor on Communications is here, Madam Oboshi Sai Kofi. Let's acknowledge her as well. Former Minister for Media Relations, Madam Elizabeth Ohine is with us. Let's acknowledge her with a round of applause. The President of the GJA, Albert, is here. Let's acknowledge him as well. Professor Stephen Adai is here with us. Let's acknowledge him with a round of applause. And a good old friend of mine, who is also here with us, the former Director of Communications at the Office of the President, Koku Anyidoho. Koku, thank you for being with us this afternoon. Rector, deans and faculty, staff and students, colleague, alumni, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I am honored, first of all, to be back here at Gimpa today, a place that holds a very special place in my heart. And on behalf of all my colleagues in the alumni who are here, we are grateful to you for the investment that you made in us. And we assure you that we'll do our best to serve our nation with the skills that you imbued in us. When Dean Ajimambudu explained why the faculty wanted me to deliver this lecture, my mind went straight to one of my recent experiences. It was in August 2019. I had just entered a high-level meeting around 4 p.m. at the Energy Ministry. 2 hours earlier, a decision had been made to suspend the agreement between ECG and PDS. I was here at this meeting to be briefed on the decision. And then following the brief, I was to come up with how the nation should be informed and at the same time assure the people of Ghana that this decision will not cause disruption to jobs and salaries. The first thing I remember was asking myself a few questions. Legally, who is mandated to suspend this agreement? And who should be briefing the country about this matter? How do I answer the questions that I will be asked following this? And as I go forward to say that it will not lead to a disruption of salaries and jobs, am I even sure that this decision will not affect jobs and salaries? How does a decision like this affect perceptions about governance? Professor Adai, in the last 5 years, staring at the photos of about 35 information ministers who have come before me, I've asked myself questions like this anytime a major matter comes up and I'm required to speak to it. I will share with you some of the answers that I've found as I lead the discussion, a legal framework for communicating governance. And I'll approach it by adhering to this outline. First, I'll define some concepts. I will invoke the literature that underpins our discussion. I will propose a theoretical lens through which we can examine the legal framework. And then we will do a proper examination of the legal framework. But I believe there are some matters beyond law that we also should discuss, after which we'll do some analysis, make some recommendations, and then I'll conclude. So let me start with the concepts. Valentsa and Bruni in 2014 argue that the word communication finds its origin in the Latin word communis, signifying common. The etymology tells us that communication is about making something shared, known, common, mutually understood. It was Severs in 2009 who posited that governance is about effectively managing a nation's resources while upholding fairness, transparency, and accountability to citizens. It is the foundation of development, promoting accountability, and responsible leadership that elevates living standards. Verding and van der Dolen in 1998 wrote that government communication is only a policy tool. It's a means for government to explain her policies and programs to the population. And when it comes to legal frameworks, we are just referring to a body of laws that apply in a particular country that gives structure to the relationship between the state and the population. So, Dean Ajimambudu, this big topic that you gave me, if I simplify it, all that we are going to talk about is how a body of laws affects the exercise of creating common understanding about the governance processes and its activities. But to enable me to do justice to this afternoon's subject, I had to consult some oracles. So I had to consult two oracles. One was literature, and then a group of experts. From literature, I found the models of reference and the lens that we'll be using for this afternoon's analysis. And from the experts, I found insights in the views shared with me by people like Mr. Kofi Totobi Kwachi, a former Minister for Information, Elizabeth Ohene, a former Minister for Information, Suleiman Abraima of the Media Foundation for West Africa, Professor Margaret Jan, academic at the University of Ghana, Mr. Koku Anyireho, who I've mentioned is here with us, he is a former Director of Communications at the Office of the President, Nana Kumia, who is a former Minister for Information, Kesel Atuforsen, who is the minority leader in Parliament currently, Kwesi Amiyawchirime, the former Majority Chief Whip or Deputy Chief Whip, all of whom have been involved in frontline communication of governance for the last 30 years. I've also been speaking to Madame Oboshi Saikofi, Mr. Mahama Ayariga, Nana Yaokese of Peace FM, and Beatrice Sedu of Asasi Radio to get perspectives. I did so because if between literature and all of these people, we cannot draw useful lessons, then Rector, maybe we should close and go home because we won't find the answers that we are looking for. We'll try. Let me start with the literature. The four theories of the press first outlined in 1956 are namely the authoritarian theory, the libertarian theory, the Soviet communist theory, and the social responsibility theory. Now, whereas these theories are derived from the point of view of the press, they are assumed to be substantial enough to facilitate a typology of how different governments communicate. Because the practice of media is informed by prevailing society. And you find that in the 1999 work of Rose Smith. Quickly, let me touch on these models. So the Soviet communist model, as explained by Sibet and his colleagues in 1956, has at its core the concept of complete state ownership and extensive control over various forms of mass media. This control is vested in the hands of selected party leaders facilitating government communication. And you find an example in North Korea. That's where state-controlled news agencies are the exclusive purveyors of information. And then there's the authoritarian model, originating 16th and 17th century from England. This model involves stringent content control by the state, limiting public freedom to critique governmental policies. It differs from the Soviet communist theory in terms of media ownership, because this one rather allows both private and public ownership. In China, you find this model operating. But content is highly regulated by the Central Propaganda Department of their ruling party. Then there's the libertarian model, which also takes its origins from European liberal thinking. It advocates media freedom devoid of government intervention and enables diverse perspectives. Media ownership predominantly resides in private hands. And this theory underscores media's role in information dissemination. It is from this theory that you get the argument made that the media is the watchdog over government. You find places like Finland exemplifying this. And then finally, the social responsibility theory. Emerging from the libertarian theory, this theory does not advocate unrestricted media use. It mandates adherence to professional standards and ethical codes. Media ownership primarily remains in private hands, guided by established standards, codes of conduct, and overarching principles. And you find it in France, Germany, the US, Japan, and many other places. Now, in Ghana from 1957 till now, we have been swinging between the extreme left and the extreme right, depending on the political order. Under military rule, government communication was characterized by centralized control, with high-ranking officials such as the head of state and the minister for information disseminating information through public statements and declarations. The military regimes tightly controlled the press and media, considering communication crucial to their role, often tying it to national security and intelligence. For instance, it's reported that the National Redemption Council had the Ministry of Information and the Publicity Secretariat, which we now call the ISD, placed directly under the authority of the chairman and head of state, Colonel Ignatius Kutua Champon. There are also times in our history where it is reported that the minister responsible for information also had an eye over national security coordination. Under military or authoritarian regimes, governance communication was primarily directive in nature. These regimes manipulated information to project positive government performance and suppress public opinion. Differentiating governance communication under military rule from what we have today, Suleimana Brahima, Executive Director of the Media Foundation for West Africa, told us when we interviewed him that communication under military governments is really about directives. You obey before you complain. In terms of even the media legislative landscape, there are differences from then as compared to what you see today, following the repeal of the criminal libel law, establishment of the National Media Commission, etc. In contrast, under the democratic dispensation, governance communication has evolved into a more fragmented landscape. Various arms of government, including party communicators, parliamentary groups, and communication around the president, have become prominent sources of government communication. And the proliferation of media outlets, almost all of which are privately owned, has significantly challenged agenda setting. The advent of smartphones and social media have also raised the bar even higher. And when it comes to the importance of communication to governance, I believe we all know it already. But Madam Elizabeth Ohene puts it succinctly when she spoke to me ahead of the preparation of this paper. I hope I don't misquote you. She says, I think it's helpful to have the president agree with you largely on the importance or otherwise of communications. And I don't know at which stage you get the whole government to agree on the priorities that have been set, because, and here's the important part, if there's general agreement that these are the priorities, then it is easier to communicate from there on. Secondly, governance communication also provides the channel through which all stakeholders, citizens, interest groups, civil society and media can engage with government and make input into programs and policies and participate in decision making. It is when we fail at this particular one that you hear after a major announcement, people or stakeholder groups will say, we're not consulted. And then in times of crisis or emergencies, communication is most essential. Active, clear, frequent communication is what enables crisis managers take timely decisions and shape behaviors. In Ghana, I'm sure that in COVID, you recall how it was handled. Public education campaigns are important because they help to create awareness about key issues like taxes, responsibilities, etc. And then for international relations, it's important to ensure bilateral and multilateral cooperation, but sometimes it makes the difference even between peace and war. Using this afternoon. There are a few theories that are relevant to the discussion before us, but the one I want to employ is the agenda setting theory. This theory enjoys considerable attention within the governance, communication, and media literature. It was Macomb's, in his work of 2004 and 2018, that suggested that political actors deliberately strive to elevate certain issues, ensuring their prominence within public discussions. It entails the media's selective curation of specific issues, vigorously highlighting them through recurrent coverage, thereby cultivating a public perception that accords paramount importance to these issues. Simply put, it may not be the only or even the most important story of the day, but it is what the key political actors choose to highlight. That's what the agenda setting theory is. So let me give you an example. In the last 2 weeks, a number of things have been happening here in Ghana. For example, cocoa prices have gone up by about 63%. At the same time, or in these same last 2 weeks, you will find that the president has been meeting the National House of Chiefs. Inflation has dropped marginally. The president has been handing over about 5 speedboats to the Ghana Navy. Also, around the same time, the president has been commissioning first oil from Jubilee Southeast Project. And oh, by the way, Parliament has been holding an inquiry on a tape purported to be evidence that the IGP is being planned to be removed. Now, can you imagine which of these became the main agenda for public discourse through mainstream media? That's the evidence of the agenda setting theory. So to best examine the legal framework and its implications, I propose that it's important to examine it through the agenda setting theoretical lens. This is because the relationship between this legal framework and agenda setting is what determines the ability of the framework to impact governance communication. So now let's look at the framework. I group the framework into 5 parts, or I separate it into 5 parts. For the first part, I deal with the Constitution. For group 2, I deal with laws around, sometimes it's a Ministry of Information, sometimes Ministry of Media Relations, sometimes it's a Ministry of Communications, sometimes directors, advisors. There are laws around that I'll deal with. Group 3, I deal with what I call the transparency laws, like the RTI Act, the Whistleblowers Act, etc. Group 4, there's a group I call the wingmen. They come in to help. Political party constitutions and the standing orders of parliament, nominate what we call party communicators, and then members of parliament on the floor of parliament. So there are some laws around them as well. They also affect agenda setting and therefore governance communication. And then finally, I deal with what I call the free media laws, like Article 167 in the Constitution. So let's start. We run an executive presidency in Ghana. But before I go there, if you go into the Constitution, I just focus on about 5 articles of importance. And starting off, you know, we run an executive presidency in Ghana. The president of the republic is the one clothed with power to exercise executive authority. Exercising executive authority includes the responsibility to communicate what is being executed, what is being done, the expected outcomes, whether we are succeeding or failing. There are also express provisions that require the president to perform specific communication assignments in furtherance of his or her governance mandate. So, for example, if you take Article 67, the president is required to appear before parliament to give what we call the State of the Nation's address. Article 36.5 requires that the president, within the first 2 years, should submit to parliament the agenda for governance. That's known as the Coordinated Program for Social and Economic Policies. Article 179 requires that the president's budget be laid before parliament. And then under Article 78, the president can nominate other persons as ministers to handle various portfolios. Here's what happens. Anytime any of these provisions is in execution, agenda setting becomes very easy and governance communication becomes very easy. Take, for example, if the president's State of the Nation or the budget is about to be read, or a key policy announcement is to be made in parliament by a minister responsible for that portfolio, automatically It makes the front pages and everybody's talking about this. So my analysis about the first group of laws that you find in this legal framework is that they are clear, they are express, they are exhaustive, and they facilitate agenda setting, which is necessary for communicating governance. Come to the second group. You notice that sometimes a president may assign somebody else with responsibility to complement the communication of governance. And studying this, you find that various heads of government have used about three different approaches. There's a group of presidents who over the years appoint a minister responsible for complementing communication of governance. Sometimes they call him the Minister for Information. Sometimes they call him the Minister for Media Relations. Sometimes they give him another name. This appointment is backed by an executive instrument. And there are other times when a president may elect to assign an already existent minister this additional responsibility. I'll share some examples shortly. When that is done, no executive instrument or instrument of legal force is given this other minister who is performing this role. And then there's a third scenario in which a president may assign an advisor to advise on the communication of governance. In this instance as well, no instrument of legal force is issued. It may even be at the same time when a ministry backed by an executive instrument is existing, supporting with that same function. So in an instance like this, de facto, the responsibility may be assigned to a higher political person, while de jure, a lower political person may have been established by EI to execute this. So let me give you a few examples. In the Jerry Rawlings administration between 93 and 2000, you will find Kofi Totobi Kwakye, Ekosi Ogbabra, John Dramani Mahama serving as ministers of communication. In the John Kufuor administration, Madame Elizabeth Ohene was appointed as Minister for Media Relations. The Mills administration returned to the Information Ministry model and designated Zita Okaikwe, John T. Akologo, Fritz Bafo as ministers for information. And then Mayaga, Minister for Communication, was given the additional responsibility to function in this role. Later, I beg your pardon, Mahama Yaga was initially Minister for Information. Later, it was collapsed, and then you find Dr. Mani Boama, Minister for Communications, being given this additional responsibility. Let's come to the Akufo-Addo era. In the Akufo-Addo I era, the Minister for Information was also the presidential spokesperson, Dr. Mustafa Abdul Hamid. His successor was Minister for Information, but not presidential spokesperson. In the Akufo-Addo II administration, a presidential advisor, Madame Obosi Saikofi, was then appointed to advise to assist in this function. So between 2009 and now, the Republic has used about six different approaches in identifying the person and trying to figure out what the role should be. But here's a more important thing. On the substantive matter of the legal framework, it appears that whether a ministry is established by EI, or an additional responsibility is given to another ministry, or directors and advisors are appointed, the proper legal instrument, a legal mandate, authority, and clarity on the spheres of influence are not provided. The EIs, and this is because the executive instruments that establish ministries in Ghana don't spell out the mandate of the ministry. They just mention the name of the ministry. One would have thought that where the EI doesn't provide that clarity, you will find it maybe in the Civil Service Act. When you go to the Civil Service Act, you'll find that there are no such details as well. In fact, Section 12 of the Civil Service Act only outlines how a ministry should be structured: finance and administration, planning, monitoring and evaluation, HR, and I think statistics. So what is the effect of this on agenda setting and governance communication? Professor Margaret Ivijan suggests that in situations like this, you have view on this. He says, when you have a unified structure, somebody at the top, and then everybody is fine, then command and control is easier, and resource It just shows sometimes the tension and the differences and the difficulties. And here's my analysis. The second group and the laws around them are less effective than the previous one in facilitating agenda setting. And this is because it lacks clarity, and actually sometimes it can create some more confusion. Let's deal with group number three, the transparency laws. The Right to Information Act, for example, Act 989, the Whistleblowers Act, Act 720. Now, with the coming into force of Act 989, information regarding governance has become a matter of proactive disclosure. This is the disclosure of information without having to wait for a request. Under Section 2 of Act 989, the government shall make available to the public general information on governance without an application from a specific person. I dare say that this facilitates agenda setting and by extension aids government or governance communication, because it allows you on your own to determine what to put out proactively and to shout it out for everybody's understanding. But it's worth mentioning that the RTI Act also has the potential to be used by other parties to fetch information for their own agenda setting purposes. Such purposes, though forming part of governance communication, may cause embarrassment to the administration of the day. And I can give a few examples. For those in the MPP, you'll be happy to recall the bus branding saga of the NDC. And for those in the NDC, you'll be happy to recall the Christmas tree saga at the airport under the MPP. It's a double-edged sword for agenda setting both ways. And then finally, let me talk about the wingman piece of legislation. With the increase in the number of radio and TV stations, as our democracy has strengthened, other players have become very relevant in the communication space and will become even more relevant moving forward. Party communicators on one side, MPs in parliament on the other side. Party communicators rely on the party hierarchy for legal authority and direction in accordance with party structures and sometimes party constitutions. MPs rely on caucus leadership in parliament sometimes, but very often they rely on their own research and their own messaging devices. If you wake up or you stand up and you catch the speaker's eye, you say what is on the top of your mind. I have two views, one from the Honorable Chairman and one from the Honorable Atoforsen, to share on this. The Honorable Chairman says if it is a matter emanating from Parliament, everybody will prefer that Parliament. Different view. He says that this is the Parliament of the Republic of Ghana. We have people that are knowledgeable and experienced in various sectors. This is the office of the minority. Of agenda setting and communicating governance. Finally, let me speak about the media freedom laws or the free media laws. The liberalization of the media ownership landscape in Ghana has created a good number of television, radio, online, and print platforms. The data from the NCA suggests that we are heading towards about 700 radio stations, over 100 TV stations, and thousands of online broadcast channels and for him, is it something newsworthy? And you can imagine, if he doesn't feel it's newsworthy, then whatever government desires to communicate will be missing in the scheme of things. Beatrice Edu of Asase Radio has another view. She says that I think media possibly is more successful in setting agenda, because if the media decides to set agenda to bring a government down or to help a government, it could. because of how it goes ahead with it, how persistent. Then it gets to convince the people who are listening or watching. Yet, Article 167C of the Constitution and the NMC Act prevent the government from exercising editorial control over any state-owned media outlet. Now, this was totally understandable when Ghanaians only had access to state-owned media. But I want to raise a question. After nearly 700 radio stations and 100 TV stations, is it still okay that government does not operate even one channel to set its own agenda? And I know you say GBC and a few others, but today's state-owned media is not under the editorial control of government. They respond only to the National Media Commission. Now, while we claim fidelity to Article 167, government still has unfettered access to its own social media channels. Is that state-owned media or not? For example, we see the new police TV channel and its very laudable content, which helps the Ghana Police Service to even if mass media is not interested in carrying what they want to put out. Because is that state-owned media? Does it offend Article 167C? Or do we admit that it is a necessary tool for agenda setting under the current developments? My friend Koku has a quote that I refer to. He says he segmented the media into two, private and state. With private, you can't really do much because the media owners have their own agenda and the presenters have their own agenda. But with public media, you may be tempted to have a conversation with them to carry the government agenda forward. But technically, any attempt to exercise editorial influence over state-owned media is unconstitutional. But is this provision still appropriate in the midst of the current developments for purposes of agenda setting? So here's my general analysis. There are parts of the legal framework where there's clarity, and those parts allow for more coherence in communicating governance and participating in agenda setting. And then there are parts of the framework that are ambiguous and lack clarity. They lack authority for the persons who are supposed to operate in there. They create a more difficult hurdle to overcome. I'm happy to inform you that having noticed this, the Office of the Counsel to the President has commenced efforts to propose a review of parts of the Presidential Office Act and the Civil Service Act and the executive instruments for setting up ministries. This should bring some more clarity and impetus for the purposes of governance and communicating governance and agenda setting. Administratively as well, the current managers of government communications have made efforts to collaborate closely with party communicators and MPs to facilitate agenda setting and the communication of governance. It should therefore be relatively easier moving forward to have all, as they say, sing from the same hymn sheet. As against sometimes different people saying different things on the same matter. But for agenda setting to be effective, a number of non-legal matters also need to be attended to. And I will speak to only five and end my submissions. The first is information sharing for communicating governance. The second is ensuring inclusivity in communications. The third is how we measure the success of communications. The fourth is managing crisis comms. And finally, how to deal with misinformation and disinformation. So I'll start with information sharing. Information sharing within government is one of the most important, yet most difficult ideals to achieve. And I see Grandma smiling at me. Traditionally, information has been managed on a need-to-know basis. For example, while many people believe that the information ministry or the party communicators who come on TV or the MPs have all the information on a particular matter, that is never the case. We only work with the briefs from the sector ministries, departments, and agencies. So unlike the president or the sector minister, we are limited to what information a specific sector minister is willing to share. Akumia has a quote on this. He says, there used to be a scenario where nobody was providing information until a crisis came. And he gave details. He said they had a situation where the entire student movement in the country were up in arms over inadequate monies that have gone through. told the country, and they students said the money can come. And there the students said the money that came was not enough. It was a big matter for government at the time. Initially, they were not getting information, but he goes on to say that because it was a crisis now, it was easy to get information. Everybody was willing to come around the table and provide information because it had now become a crisis. But ordinarily, you will struggle with this. Stringent efforts, Rector, need to be made to break the silo mentality in information sharing if agenda setting is to succeed. And pursuant to this, in 2021, the Ministry for Information, with the help and direction of the President's Advisor on Communications, introduced an online information sharing platform for ministries, departments, and agencies. The government has also subsequently instructed that all ministries should proactively provide information onto this platform to improve information sharing. In the coming years, we expect that this platform will help to reduce, if not totally eradicate, the challenge of information sharing. Let me talk about inclusivity. It is not a matter that we have approached over the decades with full attention, I must confess. Apart from a sign language interpreter in Parliament, you will recall that it was only during COVID comms that we actively focused on translations into local languages and the regular use of sign language. To the extent that inclusivity is not a dominant approach in governance communication, our ability to set agenda among people who speak minority languages and people with communication disabilities will always be at the mercy of private media for them to translate. And as you know, a lot can be lost in translation. Quickly, let me speak about measuring success. Madam Obuchi Saikofi perhaps put it most succinctly for us. She says, I think the only way you can succeed in measuring is through proper research, data and management, and analytics. It's easy to say what has to be done, but it's an component of communications management. I want to speak to the subject of human and material resource capacity. You see, governance communication often faces budgetary constraints. Proper funding is essential for effective communication, even for communication research. She goes on to say in the last quote that I gave that in our parts of the world where budgets are always very limited, it's difficult to assign enough in the budget to these measuring tools. It's very important, but it's difficult to assign enough budget. So I think we fall low on the measuring tools a lot. Nana Kumia has some views. He says, very often government has not seen communication as important enough in the allocation of resources. So if you are running a communication outfit, you must fight for resources. In 2019, for the first time, we succeeded in creating a budget line for government communication at the Ministry of Information. And we expect that moving forward, this budget line will distinctly be funded to facilitate the execution of agenda setting objectives. Let me speak to crisis communications. Ghana's response to COVID-19 was widely commended for its transparency, collaboration, and proactive communication strategies. A comprehensive assessment of countries' responses to COVID-19 was presented in a publication led by Professor Darren Lileka, an expert in political communication at Bournemouth University. It ranked Ghana and South Korea at the top of their evaluation. Suleiman Abraima, Media Foundation for West Africa, acknowledges the success of government's communication of COVID-19 in this way. He says, I think it was strategic. It was well planned. The president's occasional addresses, authorities, and other government officials on how, you know, these are extempore speeches, we are dealing with impact and how we are managing the crisis and all that. I think it was a very good example of how government can communicate around issues. Here's my point. The comms approach we were allowed to deploy for COVID should be allowed to be deployed for all regular communication of governance. And Koku has a view on that one. He says, in crisis management, you have three P's. You pity, you praise, and you promise. You can choose other language for it. Maybe showing empathy or commending, and then you give hope. And then he goes on to say, when I begin to pick up those elements in the president's crisis communication, hello Ghanaians, we are sorry about this happening. It's unfortunate that this number of deaths, blah, blah. I've spoken to the Ghana Health Authority. I've spoken to the police. I've spoken to the military. I congratulate. The battle is the Lord's. This too shall pass. In these three segmented cabins, he satisfied the basic core principles of crisis management. And I remembered exactly where I was in hope when I first commended the president that as far as I'm concerned as an expert, if I were writing the crisis communication speech for President Mills, I would have put I would have done exactly what the president did. Koku couldn't avoid bringing President Mills into this one. Rector, I want to wrap up on the subject of misinformation and disinformation. Misinformation is false or inaccurate information, and disinformation is false information which is deliberately intended to mislead, intentionally misstating facts. You find details from the American Psychological Association's publications. Now, in a study conducted by Audrey Gajeko, Gilbert Tieta, Abena Enimua Yebo Abenin, and Daniel Kwame Ampofoje, on how journalists in Ghana covered the COVID-19 vaccines, please pay attention to this. Journalists stated that they were guided by sound practices such as source credibility and relevance, but betrayed weakness in their verification practices, with a third admitting to sharing unsolicited or unverified information from social media. You'll find that in the 2023 publication of Professor Audrey Gajeko and her colleagues. A third. Honorable Chairman says, and he says this of one particular matter, the PDS matter and its communication. He says, the real intentions were declared to the people. But in a country where you have a minority, every single thing that you want to do, it seems to me that the public bought into the misinformation of the minority than the information that we of the government side were churning out. Misinformation and disinformation have a real potential, ladies and gentlemen, to even collapse our entire democracy. It is worrying that media admits increasingly falling prey to misinformation. Even more worrying is how a few political actors on both sides are also increasingly guilty of disinformation. Let me speak briefly about sincerity in communicating governance. Communicators of governance should be sincere at all times. Because in particular, we live in the post-truth era where faith in political leaders has been eroded, and we must make extra efforts to be sincere at all times. I admit, sometimes we may get things wrong based on the briefs that we have been given, but we should never deliberately go out there to mislead the public. We should also encourage the mainstream media to focus more on unearthing the fact for the public to make up their own minds, and less on personal opinions and commentary. For political and civil society actors, we should bear in mind that if we keep investing so much in undermining each other's sincerity, then we should not be surprised if the public forms the view that all of us are insincere. Even our charges at each other should not be full of lies and concoctions. They should be genuine and fair and based on the truth. Rector, I want to conclude with a few recommendations. Number one, the parts of the legal framework that are ambiguous require some urgent clarity, and efforts to secure amendment that bring clarity should be sped up. Number two, the cabinet instructions to all ministries, departments, and agencies to share and facilitate agenda setting should be enforced. Number three, efforts to improve inclusivity in government communications through sign language and interpretation into local languages should be maintained and even mainstreamed. It should be the norm and not the exception. Number four, the template developed for crisis communications during COVID should be reviewed and utilized regularly. And finally, we need to build some consensus to deal with the growing threat of misinformation and disinformation, and this should be done quickly. And consensus is necessary because it's a slippery slope. You might infringe on press freedoms. It might be viewed incorrectly politically. And so there is the need for consensus to be built to deal with this, and it should be done quickly. Chairman, if you invited me today to speak to the subject of a legal framework for communicating governance, I hope my thoughts will help advance this field. In the coming years, I look forward to joining us here from other alumni on the interplay between the law and the practice in their own fields as well. I'm grateful for the opportunity.
terms of structuring the communication, first of all, there must be a lead. If it's the ministry, let it be the ministry.
I think the ideal situation would be to have a coordinating committee involving Office of the President, Ministry of Information, Party, and Parliament, so that we are one.
My recollection is that there was no structure, that we made it up as we went along. The spokesperson for the president or incoming president was assumed to be the spokesperson for everybody.
And so I do not really support that kind of centralized communication. I can support a form of clearinghouse where you want them to clear policy announcement or pronouncement.
May 9th was the football match between Hearts and Kotoko. That was bad. The people of Ghana needed to know as quickly as possible exactly what happened, how it came about that so many young people died. That if we found out what had happened, then we could put in place things to ensure that it didn't happen again. So that was the crux of what we were supposed to do.
In crisis management, you have three P's: you pity, you praise, and you promise. Choose other language. You show empathy. You commend, then you give hope.
It's important to get the people on your side. So you want them to be aware, but you want them to, as much as possible, accept and come on board with what you're doing so that they can be part of it and so that they can understand what benefits will accrue to themselves and to the nation as a whole.
The truth to avoid crisis is when you confront the situation head on from the beginning.
I'm a great believer in, I got this wrong, I'm sorry. And I'm a great believer in that. Something is bad, it's bad.
Maybe within Parliament, you can't centralize it. You can't say that every single thing must go through the office of the minority leader.
You need to get that aspect of your appointment right, so that when that person is managing, the other colleagues don't see him as just one of us politicians. No, we think one will share if confirmation means no. Or you're a professional. He's a professional.
That the important thing was that the whole government should be seen to be singing from the same hymn sheet.
A structure or a non-structure, where you have different centers of communication. Oh, that is a recipe for failure. One important thing about political communication is for you to be singing from the same hymn sheet, whether you are true or false.
Now, the number one agenda setter is government, because it is believed that government have the resources. And sometimes the opposition also come into the fray.
Government generates whatever issues that need to be discussed. But it is the media that picks it and mirror the society and then make the society to understand which part of the economy is government tackling most and tackling less.
ISD played a central role. And mind you, many of the communication is political. You had a situation in this country where a deputy minister was telling ISD people that they should go and lie. If the thing is black, they should say it's white. And if the government gave 10,000, they should say it's 50,000, which of course isn't going to be possible because these are civil servants. No. But then, so then with this mindset, they will sidestep ISD and go to their own communicators. It needs to be re-engineered.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I believe we can give the Minister of Information another round of applause. I had no doubts in my mind that he was going to deliver, and indeed, he delivered beyond my own expectations. But of course, that's what a Gimpa education does. So it's not too surprising. Mr. Minister, we're not done with you. I would respectfully invite you to come on stage for us to have a little chat, fireside chat. The questions you put to Madam Oboshi, Sai Kofi, Madam Elizabeth Ohine, I'm coming to put the same questions to you. So please, respectfully, if you could join me briefly. We're not going to be long. We'll just take a few minutes to have a conversation.
Let me start by saying I reserve the right to invite help to answer me some of the questions.
This is not an open book exam. It's a closed book. It's a closed book one. Thank you once again, Honorable Minister, for that insightful lecture. Indeed, I learned a lot from it. My own understanding of agenda setting had been influenced by what we hear. In recent times, we hear things like some particular journalists being agenda setting individuals, but in a negative sort of sense, like agenda nyame and things of that, so which I know you know what I'm talking about. But my first question to you would be, in light of the agenda setting theory, that theoretical framework that you used in your delivery, at what point would you say that in communicating governance, you or whoever is given that task should say, I got it wrong, or we got it wrong, we are sorry?
So there are different parameters. First, I'll deal with a matter of agenda setting, and then I'll deal with admissions. So agenda setting is not a bad thing. In fact, if you speak to any media practitioner, they'll tell you that the first part of their job is to set the agenda. Because the media is the one that determines what you see on the front pages, what you hear on the radio, what you'll be thinking about. And like I tried to demonstrate, you can have 1,000 things going on in Ghana in a particular week. In that particular week, it was 1/6 of the things that was going on that had to do with the probe in parliament. And the other 5 things which we believed were developmental, helping the country and pushed very hard to be covered, the media will tell you, like some of the media persons told us, yeah, this one won't get me the audience, this is what will get me the audience. So that's what I want to cover live. So the media admits, you know, agenda setting. But I think my point is that government should not be shy of getting involved in agenda setting, because the only way you can communicate governance properly is by participating in agenda setting. It is a question of the tools at your disposal to help set the agenda. Some of those tools are legal, like we looked at. Some of them are financial. Some of them are even constitutional, and that's why I raised Article 167C, that maybe we should start asking that question again. At a time when we had only one GBC and one or two newspapers, it was understandable to say the media should not, or government should not have any say in it. Does that still pertain today? I don't know. The second part of your question has to do with admissions. And I think, as some of my seniors mentioned, where we have gotten it wrong, we should be able to say we have gotten it wrong. And sometimes we get it wrong for various reasons. You may get, as I demonstrated earlier, we are not the substantive sector. We get briefs every evening based on what we think is going to make the headlines the next day. We get, you know, issues raised, and then we try to get information. If you don't get the right brief, you may go out and say X or Y or Z, only to find out the following day that what you put out was incorrect. And at that point, you should be able to say, I got it wrong. Mm. There are times also when you may genuinely not get it wrong, but somebody else in the political ecosystem wants to create an impression that you got this one wrong, and therefore you should, may I say, admit and apologize. And you'll find persons who communicate to governments insist that, no, I didn't get this wrong. So I think it's dependent on the scenario at play that you would act accordingly.
Mm. So should government communication be centralized?
I am not really worried about the model you use. I think for me what is more important is that the authority relationships, the mandates are fleshed out clearly so that you can bring everybody together, as they said, sing from the same hymn sheet and we can all be one. in particular the growing wings, or the wingmen as I describe them, will even become more important as our democracy grows. And it's important we fashion out a way that brings all of them under one umbrella.
Mm. One of the main, would I say, accusations, or one of the main things that usually your government, and in particular your ministry, is attacked or is hit with, is the fact that it seems as if a lot may be going on, but you're not effectively communicating, and that people do not know what is actually happening. So for instance, in 2020, I remember that there was this delivery tracker, which was more political than governance oriented. And I'm happy that you mentioned that there was now an information sharing platform and all those kinds of things. How do we practically, using this theory that we've just been exposed to, streamline government communications in a way that is effective, not necessarily to push any political agenda, but the developmental agenda of the country, which we are all interested in?
I think the first thing is closer collaboration for information sharing within government, so that you're able to get a lot more information that you need for the purposes of agenda setting. I think the second thing is to examine the tools and the infrastructure at your disposal. Mm. In fact, in the last same week that we are talking about, for those of you who have been paying attention to television, you've been seeing a lot of Agenda 111 projects being shown on your television. You are seeing a lot of things about, cocoa pricing and forums that are going on being showed on your television. That is because, like I said, in the constitutional provisions, the ministers responsible for those sectors have shared information. So it makes it very easy to put it out. Mm. And if you have other spaces where there's a difficulty in sharing information, you will have a difficulty in putting it out. That's the first one. The second one has to do that, even when you have it, how much does it cost to get airtime across 5 or 6 or 8 television stations and put it out there? Because in reality, you don't control any channel. Yeah. GBC charges me for putting my things on television, and it's understandable. And that's why I say that, for example, you got to take a second look at Article 167C and ask if it's still relevant today.
Mm. Closely related to that, you mentioned in your presentation laws such as the right to information law, the whistleblowers law, and you group that in one category for the purposes of your analysis. How, in your opinion, and in line with this theory, agenda setting theory, which I'm getting used to now and is exciting my own intellectual path, how do these laws influence public perception in terms of governance? In your experience, because you're in the Ministry of Information, and having seen through the passage of the RTI, for instance, would you say that it has helped in terms of our governance generally, and in terms of communication of governance?
So they have the potential, in particular the Right to Information Act has the potential to significantly improve the communication of governance. And particularly if you pay attention to the proactive disclosure part of the Act, which require ministries, departments, and agencies to very regularly on their own, even when nobody has requested for information, set the agenda by proactively putting out there what they are doing about this and what they are doing about that. We have the devices at the Ministry of Information ready to support any of those functions. But it means that people who run all of these public institutions, because the law talks about public institutions, first need to know the law, second need to pick it up, and based on that, do a lot of proactive disclosure. Because if you don't, there's another part of the law that allows anybody to come searching for information and to use that information for whatever purposes. Mm. And I say that that is even part of agenda setting in governance. Mm. Except that often when people are looking for that information, they are not looking for that information to promote the work of government or for the communication of governance. They are going to use it to say, of all the 500 things you have done, here's one example of something that went bad. And oh, by the way, that means you are so bad.
And how do you respond to something like that?
Well, it is the law and it allows them to do that. It is part
how do you respond to, yes, you've done 500 other things, that's wonderful. But somebody points to that one thing that you didn't do, or you haven't done well, or you've done wrongly. How would you respond to that?
Because that person is setting their agenda, is framing issues or seeking to frame issues in that way. The onus on us on this other side is therefore to profusely use this side to set agenda, to push out there what we have done. And as I've mentioned, that depends on the collaboration. That depends on how much interest people in the system have in supporting communications so that they can make all of this available. I mean, if you are doing something great in your ministry, department, or agency, it must be in your first interest that we want the world to know about it. But if you are doing something great in your ministry, department, or agency, and you would not open up, you would not share information, it would take a miracle for anybody to help you communicate the kind of governance that you're exercising in your part of the bigger ecosystem.
All right. So I have a few questions that have come in, and we're wrapping up this conversation shortly. I have a last question for you, but let me read one or two questions that we're getting from our live stream on GTV, on Adum TV, and City TV as well. So an individual called Grace says, Ghana is a secular multicultural state. The different cultures we have reflect the diversity of approaches to communicating and being communicated to. As a government mouthpiece, I believe there's a critical consideration of these cultural contexts in communicating governance. So the question is, how can we incorporate our cultural dynamics into this proposed legal framework?
So the Information Services Department is the one that helps us to answer that question very well. Because the Information Services Department focuses on what we call below the line communication, on the ground. Above the line, we use a lot of mass media, social media, digital tools.
What does below the ground communication mean?
So there is what they call the visibility line. And above the line is what everybody can see. So that's what you see on television, here on radio, on billboards, in print. That's above the line. And then we have what we call below the visibility line, where you see on ground. So in a community, maybe in the church or in a school or in a mosque or at the chief's palace or under the baobab tree, how do we gather and using the local cultural nuances do the necessary communication as is required? And that's why I say the ISD is the vehicle that is best placed to help us be culturally sensitive within this communication framework, agenda setting, and everything else. The challenge over the years is that successive governments have not invested enough in the Information Services Department. And it's something that we need to take a lot more seriously and invest in so that they have the capacity to go to every village, community, wherever, and get the message to ground. Because if you assume that doing one press conference in Accra means the person in Hamele has understood it in the local language, then we are deceiving ourselves. But what are the tools or the devices that we are making available so that we can turn that message, that press conference from ECG and PDS, we can turn it into the Sisala language for it to get to the person on the ground so that misinformation and disinformation will be cured. Else, that gentleman will be there and somebody will come tell him that the government has taken this particular asset and has sold it to itself, and there's no means of getting communication to him to clear that misinformation or disinformation, and that will make the communication of governance almost impossible.
One more question. So this is coming from Peter. He says, we were not consulted has become a popular mantra in our public discourse in recent times. From the announcement and rollout of the DDEP, that's a domestic debt exchange program, to issues surrounding COVID expenditure and the fight against Galamsey. How do we as a country balance the need for urgent communication on issues of national concerns with the necessity to consult extensively in governance communication in a democracy such as ours? Does the existing framework provide any guiding perspectives on that?
That's a Section B A-level question. I think we have to go back to the very top to understand that communication. I think one of the, by the way, in 45 minutes, I cannot even quote everything that all the resource persons I spoke to, you know, shared with me. And I'm informed that all of those are being put together in a final publication, which will be peer-reviewed and then published with an electronic version as well. In that, one of the persons we spoke to, I think it was Akomia, makes the point that we need to get to the point that we have a clear understanding that communication is at the heart of the entire governance exercise. Even right from the very beginning, when we are formulating the policy or the program, we need to get the comms people, we have very experienced comms people in the room, to understand what it is we want to do, and even to troubleshoot for us that this one will not go well, this one will not go right. In fact, there have been times when it has taken communications people in caucus detail interview to prevent major national security disasters because they were able to piece together a few things that they were picking up in the communication architecture. So it goes to an understanding right from the very beginning. And it is when we don't do that that you hear people say we were not consulted. Mm. It's when we operate in the old model of information is on a need-to-know basis. That then stakeholders in the ecosystem and other people don't know. And you can have a nice ceremony to make the announcement, but everybody will say, we're not consulted. And now you have a PR crisis on your hands. Mm. The problem is not a PR problem. The problem is a substantive governance problem that needs to be tackled that way.
Mm. So finally, Honorable Minister, in conclusion, the Ministry of Information, the Directorate at the Presidency, responsible for information or presidential spokesperson and all that. What is the way forward? What is the model, the ideal model in your world that should be adopted? Because we went through several, you pointed out in your lecture, several different models. And even from 2009 to date, we've gone through six different ones.
Who knows? We may have a seventh one.
So my final question to you is, which one of these six, or which other iteration of any of the six would you prefer?
I think the current system is the best system, where you have, you know, along the four parameters, different people in charge, and then you have a supervisor at the top who is able to help bring coordination so that we all first know the hymn book, and then the hymn sheet that we are singing.
And the hymn number.
And the hymn number. Mm. Else when you say hymn 111, if some people are holding the Methodist hymn book and some are holding the Catholic hymn book, you will hear different songs.
Together, yeah.
So I think the current model is the best. And that's why you find me mention that the current model has helped us to unearth a lot of gaps. And it is from this that already conversations are going on about the amendments to the Presidential Office Act, the Civil Service Act, and the executive instruments, so that it's able to institutionally provide the kind of clarity that we are bringing to bear today on the sector.
Thank you very much, Kojo. Ladies and gentlemen, a proud Gimpa alumnus, the Honorable Minister for Information, Kojo Opor-Nkrumah. We can do it better for him, please.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we're wrapping up today's event. We've had the official launch of the Gimpa Alumni Association. Of course, we all saw that unique logo which embodies the very essence and journey of the Alumni Association. We've also had a thorough public lecture, which, of course, in addition to the fireside chat, which touched on the crucial intersection of law, governance, and communication. I'd call on the rector of Gimpa to give us the closing remarks. Please welcome Professor Samuel K. Bonsu.
I blame my mother for this. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure that you will agree with me that Gimpa is truly the center of excellence, and there is a lot of room for us to maintain and improve on it as we go forward. I see Professor Adai here. When I mentioned his name earlier, he wasn't with us, but welcome, and thank you for laying the foundation for us. So I'm still overwhelmed, you know, filled with excitement, filled with the sense of challenge. But I'm also, as I listened to the honorable speaker, I was filled with hope. There is hope for us. We are now looking at ways of improving the... You made me blame my mother for nothing. We ways of improving communication that will facilitate more effective governance in our system. It's not just for governance. I think we also, I picked up a few lessons that will apply to Gimpa, or to my own role at Gimpa here. But I think that this launch, the public lecture that goes along with it, has allowed us to think beyond just alumni as friends. It's also an opportunity to make a contribution to our national development. And I believe that, you know, this today, the meeting today has ignited in us and will continue to ignite in us the spirit of togetherness, the spirit of citizenship, and the possible unity that binds us. And we're doing all this through our esteemed Gimpa. So I'd like to thank all those who have contributed to this event and to other things that benefit Gimpa and the country. Once again, thank you. Now, this is, ours is not just an alumni association. It is not just a network. I believe that we are beginning to see the value and benefit of us being members of one family, being a support system for each other, helping each other grow, helping each other support the country, not just ourselves. We are now creating, through this alumni platform, through this alumni association, a platform that is going to help us all work together to encourage each of us to engage in lifelong learning. Honorable Minister was asking me earlier if he was too old to be a part of a learning environment here, and I told him that you're never too old to come to Gimpa. We are always ready to share whatever knowledge we have with anybody, regardless of age. And I specifically said that even if when you know you're old enough and you're dying tomorrow, we'll still encourage you to join us before you go. So we are always open, you know, and the lunch here, you know, is also part of that. I see very young people, I see very old people. We are looking at cross-generational engagements, and that is the spirit of Gimpa. So let's not forget, those of us who are alumni, that we are not just alumni, we are also ambassadors of Gimpa. We will work together to raise and mentor the next generation of leaders of this country. Not just the legal minds, but leadership across the country. That is one of the key things that Gimpa stands for and that we are noted to do and do well. I believe that we have the power to shape the next generation. We have the power to shape the future. And we have the power to make Gimpa the beacon of legal education, leadership education in this country, in Africa and beyond. And I encourage each one of us, all of us, to actively engage with the Alumni Association, the Gimpa Law Association, Gimpa Law Alumni Association. As I indicated earlier, this is only the beginning. It's one of many that we're going to be looking at. We're looking at Gimpa Law, which we have just seen. We're looking at Gimpa Business. We're looking at Gimpa Leadership. We're looking at Gimpa Governance. We're looking at Gimpa Technology. And you'll be seeing a series of these activities where we'll be inviting you once again to join us to become what we have always been, the center of excellence to contributing to the development of our dear country through our beloved institution. So we will do our best to stay in touch with our alumni, and we hope that you do the same, or at least we'll try. We'll encourage you to try to do the same. We'll invite you to our various events, as I indicated earlier. We'll be knocking on your door as we need help, not just in financial terms. We'll be doing that. But sometimes we also need your expertise. We need your other resources, non-financial resources, to facilitate the goal, the achievement of the goals, mission, and vision of Gimpa. So I'd like to thank you all for being a part of today's event, being here with us. We know you could have been in so many other places, but you chose to be with us today. We cannot underestimate the value of that, the importance that you attach to us as Gimpa. I eagerly anticipate the incredible path that awaits us, all of us, working together. alumni, friends of Gimpa, and I know you believe that together we'll make this nation far better than it is currently. My Gimpa, your Gimpa, our Gimpa. Gimpa Law Association, Law Alumni Association, Akwaba, Waba, Tnasi. And before we go, I think there is a small presentation that would like to make to our distinguished speaker.
Please help me welcome the Minister for Information, Honorable Kwejo Nkrumah. We're grateful, Honorable Minister, for joining us today. Please, a round of applause. Kindly do it better for Rector as well. Please do take note of this announcement. And right after, we would have a photo section, which would encompass the Dean, the Rector, and the Minister for Information, as well as all the special guests that I've invited here. Right, so the Gimpa Faculty of Law has started, or is about to start, the rolling out some new and innovative Masters of Laws degrees program in January and February 2024. This will include a general LLM program, LLM in International Business and Trade Law, LLM in Dispute Resolution Law and Practice, and LLM in International Criminal Law and Justice. Interested alumni of Gimpa Law are kindly requested to submit the following details to facilitate a smooth application process and receive further information. We have a team at the entrance, so please, you can just note down your details and would communicate with you. Please, let's welcome on stage the Minister for Information, Honorable Kwejo Nkrumah, the Rector of Gimpa and the Dean of Faculty of Law for the first photo section. Please, a round of applause. All right. Can we have all the special invited guests, please? Honorable Ministers of State, please kindly let's all join. The special guest, Honorable Ministers of State. Great, we can have management of Gimpa, please join us on stage. So we can have a very big group photo.
No, please, you're not going. Let's join and have them. All of them.
The Honorable Minister.
Please, management of Gimpa, Honorable Ministers, please, let's have a group photo. Thank you. Please, you can help them with a round of applause. It has been a great day here today, and let me add that today is not just a moment to celebrate our past, but also one to embrace our present and look forward to a promising future. Thank you for joining us. My name is Frimpong Wiafi Joshua, and we have the VIP cocktail just behind. So the VIPs, we use this section, and we have the other cocktail section.